In culmination of our discourse on natural resource management law, the final limb of our discussion on specific ecosystems and their management, we get into an inquiry of water policy and law. This is a very huge area for discussion. As we get into the details of the discussion in this session, you will find the legal regime, both at the international and at the domestic level, are not very clearly defined, described, or determined. The reasons for the same you will be able to find as we get along into the discourse. This is an attempt in introducing the student to the vast regime of water policy and law. First, with a little backdrop of international legal regime, followed by what prevails at the domestic level in India. It's a very complex area. The complexity of this particular area of law is primarily due to the fact that there is nothing like the water law or the water policy. Both in the international sense of the term, or even for that matter, at the domestic level. And much of the water law discourse, as we see, is essentially related to so many other ecosystems which either are enclosing a water body or is there alongside a water stream. The rights, entitlements, claims, and obligations in relation to the other aspects of the natural resources have a bearing on the very fashioning of the law and the working of water, its policy, and its administration. As such, this is a very difficult terrain to traverse, and there is no single work in the world which has completely captured the very essence of the water law all over. So, what we seek to do today in this particular session is only to take a panoramic view of that, to identify the major features of it and get a grasp of the extent, the contours, the dimensions, and the depths of the law concerning water. As we begin, I just introduce you to a cartoon just to understand the enormity of the situation. As you look at the cartoon, you do notice a group of people making a clamor not for anything else other than water. And if you consider this island like formation as earth with so much of water surrounding it, and food packages are coming their way to relieve them from the pang of hunger, the demand from the people is about water. One may wonder, when there is so much of water all around, why are they really making a craving for water when it's available in plenty? Please look at the fact there. Yes, 71% of the earth's surface is water, but only 4% of it is fresh water, and of that 4%, hardly 0.5% is safe for human consumption. I'm quite sure you are able to understand the enormity of the situation and the difficulty that the people are experiencing and would justify why there is so much of demand for water when there is plenty of water all around. Let us just take a look at some of the factual situations to further understand the real backdrop for our understanding of the law. A few facts. Water is the elixir of life. Water is a renewable resource, but a very limited resource, as the fact that I conveyed to you earlier conveys or reveals. 70 to 75% of water of Earth is covered by water. And if you just make a contrast and make a comparison, you would find that the same proportion of composition of human body, you know, the human body, 70 to 75% of it is made of water only. So what you see around you as to the share of water is almost the same as you have within you. 95% of Earth's water is found in the oceans. Can't drink it, can't use it for any human purpose, and hardly 3% of the rest is available as fresh water. Look at the facts further. Of this 3%, 2.5% is unavailable. It is locked up in glaciers, polar ice caps, and in the atmosphere, and in the soil. Highly polluted, and also beneath the Earth's surface. And so what you have, hardly 0.5% of Earth's water is fresh water, and that's available for our use. This supply is continually collected, purified, and distributed in a natural hydrological cycle. India has about 2% of the land surface and 16% of the population of the world. It does not have the kind of water that every one of us would drink and have it in surplus quantity. India is one of the water deficient countries in the world. That 0.5% of fresh water I did mention, look at the other fact. In nature, there is an uneven distribution of fresh water, with a few areas having excess of it and a whole lot of the rest having very scarce supply. And even the rainfall, which is the main source of fresh water, is not uniformly distributed. And as we are experiencing, owing to the cataclysmic variations in climatic conditions, as we are not just witness to, but we are experiencing now, the number of rainy days in any given rainy season have come down. And it is so erratic that there are very heavy rain days on some and only traces of it in the rest of the season. So, look at the unevenness of distribution, not just of fresh water in different topographies of the world, but even the rainfall is unevenly distributed even within a season. To add to the problem, when we get into water governance, you do see it is sectoral in nature, operating in silos, with hardly any coordination and harmony in their functioning. Like in nature, our system of governance with regard to water is nothing but chaos. Water is not administered, is not managed, is not regulated by any single entity anywhere in the world. I'll just give you an example. Take the example of the state of Karnataka. In the state of Karnataka, water resources, as part of the system and scheme of governance, is distributed among 25 odd departments in the government. Yes, you heard me right. 25 odd departments. That means water is not viewed homogeneously as single, continuous, seamless whole. But in terms of administration, it is divided into 25 odd parts. And problem of coordination, harmony, the functioning is very seriously here. And Karnataka is a microcosm of India. It's there everywhere, the same kind of a problem. Against this backdrop, we need to examine the policy and the law to regulate water, its use, management, conservation, and the availability, access to it, so on and so forth. Let us first go a little deeper into seeing as to why the situation is so problematic with regard to water. This light perhaps would give you an idea that in law, if you examine the identity and status of water, this is an orphan. Water has no independent identity of its own in law. Its status, its identity, they are determined by, number one, the nature of the ecosystem. If it is in a national park, then the rules that are applicable in relation to a national park would have a bearing upon accessing that water, water body, the rights in relation to that, and the entitlements. Supposing it is there in a wetland, in a public place, then the kind of rights and entitlements that the people have over the piece of land abutting this wetland would determine the kind of access right, the use right, and the management right in relation to water. So, water and its status is dependent on the ecosystem that is very closest to it. And let us look to the rights in relation to water. Well, the rights in relation to water is determined by land rights. If it is a public property, the community of people who have been using that will have a communitarian right as determined either by tradition, custom, practices that they have, or as determined by a statutory formulation. If it is on private land, exclusive property. You may have plenty of water in a well that is there on your piece of land. You will have 100% ownership right over that. Nobody else can claim anything. Even if the neighboring land is a parched land, sorry, he cannot have any claim over the excess water that you have on your piece of land, because the right in relation to water is determined by the ownership right that one has over land. And the status of water is further determined by its availability on the surface. If it is a running stream of water, then like a river, then you have several claimants to it. There is no single owner. There is no single right holder. There will be plenty of right holders all along the banks of that river. All along the banks of river, right from the starting point till it either reaches another river or it joins the sea or wherever it goes, all throughout its course, the rights in relation to that same stream of water is varied. Those who are in the upstream have a different kind of a status and a right, and those who are in the downstream have a different kind of a right, entitlement, and claim. And supposing it's a water body which is locked up in a lake or in a tank, then those who are in its immediate neighborhood, who are the owners of the plots of land abutting this water body, they will have relatable claims in relation to water in that particular water body. When it is there on surface, I said there are so many claimants, depending upon its availability and in what form it is available. But when it is available underground, in which case it belongs to the owner of the land. Very complex thing. The complexity with regard to the discourse on water is inbuilt into the very discourse on land rights, land entitlements. And water rights, water entitlements, regulation in relation to water is determined by and mired in land in relation to land and other ecosystems which are there alongside this as part of its environment. So much as a background for our understanding of water law and policy. Given this kind of a confusing state of affairs with regard to water, let us quickly have a look at the international legal landscape in relation to water. As I did mention, that water and the rights in relation to that is solely, wholly and entirely determined by the ecosystem in which it exists. And normally the land or the territory. And you know, when it comes to international legal positions with regard to water, it is primarily determined by the territorial right of a state. So, if a nation has its borders clearly defined, the waters that are there within that entirely belongs to it, because it's a sign of its sovereign authority. And so, water that is not international in nature and is confined to the territorial limits of any nation state, it is entirely the lookout of the nation state system, and it does not come within the purview of international law at all. There are very few exceptions. Exceptions are essentially something which actually prove the rule that water within a particular country, sovereign right and legal regulation is entirely left to the lookout of that particular state. Exceptions like wetlands. If there is a wetland of international significance and if it has been so identified in one of the earlier modules, our discourse, we have already seen that if it is a wetland of international significance, then the rules and regulations with regard to the Ramsar Convention on wetlands would determine that. Other than that, by and large, a water stream that is running through the territory of one single state, not shared with any other state or a country, it is entirely, exclusively within the sovereign authority of a state. International has nothing to do with that. As a general rule, even those water streams or rivers or water bodies like lakes that are transnational in nature, that means shared by two or more nations, even these are regulated through an understanding amongst those very states or nations which share them. It may be through a bilateral or a regional arrangement. They will work out and negotiate and work out the arrangement as to the claims, rights and entitlements and responsibilities in relation to them. So international law does not really step in there also. Nonetheless, a very few effort is being made at the international level, which either lay down certain broad general principles or guidelines for governments. Their enforcement or resolution of conflicts in relation to them are not really something to crow about. They're quite weak and they're left to the parties to choose mechanisms that suit them. Following is a very brief account of some of those international initiatives in this regard. Let's start with principles. Well, there is no single universally accepted principle in application, and some of the following merit attention. These are put across argued about, but there is nothing like universally accepted. The first one is the Harman doctrine, very popular, prevalent all over the world. The Harman doctrine is the doctrine of absolute sovereignty. See, the argument runs somewhat like this. This is a stream of water that is running through my country. It may be going into the neighboring country, or it may have come through the other country and is passing through mine to be emptied into my neighboring country, whatever it is, whether it is international in nature or it is purely within my country. All that matters is the river, the water stream is within my territory. And within my territory, I, as the sovereign state, I have complete and an absolute sovereign right over it. This is a doctrine of absolute sovereignty, which is normally claimed by what are called as upstream states. And this has been made famous by United States of America, quite understandably, to claim complete authority over all the waters that are there within your territory and which passes through your territory. But in international relations and international treaty arrangements, this is not favored or even enforced in any international treaty. But time and again, whenever there is an advantageous position for any state, states have put forth this argument of the Harman doctrine of absolute sovereignty. Then, the extreme opposite of it is another doctrine. Doctrine of absolute riverine integrity. It is a claim of downstream states. If it is a riverine system running through two countries, let's assume, the state of origin or the country of origin is called as the upstream state, and the country where the river ends is called as the downstream state. The Harman doctrine is the claim of the upstream state, and the doctrine of absolute riverine integrity is the claim of downstream states. What is that? It simply means it is the entitlement of every riparian state for the natural flow of the river crossing its borders. That means, see, whether it is there in my territory or in your territory, it should not matter. River has a status and identity of its own. River should be allowed to run through its natural course in its natural way, and we cannot tamper with that. And that's the claim, absolute riverine integrity. For the river to remain a river, we should not block it. We should not tamper with it. We should not pollute it. We should allow it to run its course naturally. I mean, it's a very ideal claim. And normally those who are in the downstream would always claim this because they want to have unpolluted water to be available to them. And the upstream people would say, come on, this is the water that is there, it is there for our use, and they use and abuse, misuse, and send polluted water to the downstream. And the downstream people say, oh, you have polluted the river. The river cannot be polluted because it has its own identity, something like that. Well, the real conflicts are very much there in these two extreme arguments. Neither the first one is favored, nor even the second one, because upstream countries do not agree with the second doctrine, downstream countries do not agree with the first doctrine. Then, what is something which is acceptable? Is there a golden mean? Yeah, there is a third principle. The principle of doctrine of limited territorial sovereignty. Look, you have a right. I also have a right. You are the upstream state. I am the downstream state. Why should we quarrel? We should learn to adjust and manage the situation. How do we manage? Both of us will agree that both of us have a right to a reasonable, equitable use. And when we have the right, we also have an obligation not to cause significant harm. This looks wonderful on paper. It's just give and take. I have a right to use, let me use. You too have a right to use, you also use it. My right to use shall not come in the way of your right to use. That kind of a thing. And while we are using it, let us not harm the integrity of this water resource, because it should be available for us, for our generation of people, for generations of people to come. And so we will only use these resources in such a way which would do equity to us, to meet our needs, respective needs, and the kind of demands that we have, but also to be available for all times to come. Well, in principle, there is an agreement over this in all international arrangements. But the devil lies in the detail. How do you work out what is equitable use? How do you consider something as reasonable? What do you mean by harm? How do you quantify significant harm? These are all very loaded expressions, and over which there are a lot of disputes, disagreements, negotiations, and various means and mechanisms of using good officers and conciliation and mediation measures to resolve conflicts. But by and large, this is a principle which has currency, validity, and in use in international relations. And around this, various international arrangements are crafted. So what are the international legal arrangements that we have? Conventions and treaties. As I said, to legislate upon water of this dimension and nature internationally is almost an impossible thing. And precisely for this reason, we don't have a single umbrella law at the international level which deals with water resource to be binding on each and every country which is a party to it. So, what you have are international arrangements, but which are with reference to certain aspects of water resource, its conception, its use, the nature of access, its management, the relative claims and settlement of disputes in relation to that. So there are certain common meeting grounds that has been worked out, and we just have a very few internationally accepted legal arrangements. The first one is the Water Courses Convention. It is a convention on the law of non-navigational uses of international water courses. This was concluded in New York in the year 1992. There are 36 parties for this convention. Remember that there are more than 200 countries in the world. So it is a very limited appeal. But this is by and large one of the biggest international arrangement, and that's the reason I have made a mention of it. There are 36 parties, and if you actually look to who are all these parties, they are by and large arrangements amongst European states and some African countries, and just a couple of East Asian countries are part of it, no more. 36 countries are members of this arrangement, so it is applicable only to those 36 countries. And also have a look at the slide here. Although the international arrangement was entered into in 1992, it could come into force only from the year 2014, very recent. 22 years it took for them to get into higgling and haggling, bargaining, to come to a consensus as to how, when, and in what manner this particular arrangement needed to work even among those small group of nations. The second one is what is referred to as the Water Convention. It is a United Nations Economic Commission for Europe Convention on the Protection and Use of Transboundary Watercourses and International Lakes. And this was worked out in Helsinki, Finland, in the year 1992. And as you could make out, it is confined only to the European countries, and 41 countries are parties to this. And this arrangement is in force since 2015. That is also very recent. And so, in terms of effect, it is very difficult to really say how impactful, how valuable this international experience has been. It is too short a period of time for a call and to decide on that, but it is just taking off. Then you have the European Economic Commission protocol on water and health. This was concluded in London in the year 1999. The object is to protect human health and well-being by better water management and by preventing continuation or continuing affliction resulting from water-related diseases. I must say, it has come up with a very sound framework for a human right to safe water and sanitation. This is a very important arrangement, and this is very much in practice, primarily in the European countries, because it comes as a protocol to that European arrangement. Then you have separate arrangements for major international rivers like Nile, Danube, Nile in Africa, Danube and Rhine in Europe, Colorado in the North American continent, Amazon in South America, Mekong in Asia. As many as 7 countries are parties to that in Mekong arrangement. They have arrangements among river basin countries. So, you have one something which a large group of nations are parties to, and by and large, that is something that is being worked at the international level, are agreements in relation to major international rivers, only among those riverine countries which are the river basins of these many rivers that I have just mentioned. And once again, one more fact with regard to the international law. 60% of transboundary water river basins do not have any agreements. And even those that are having international agreements, 80% of these agreements are only bilateral in nature. And so, all basin countries are not involved. Supposing a river feeds, basin country is a country or a landscape which is fed by that river. So, if there are about 10 basin countries, and if it is a bilateral agreement, that means it is applicable only to 2 countries. The remaining 8 countries are not parties to that. So, very limited scope and application. And even amongst these agreements, quite a large number of them, they do not provide for sharing of data or information. They do not establish water allocation and benefit sharing criteria or processes. They do not contain conflict resolution rules. They do not apply the entire river basin or aquifer systems. Then what do they relate to? Only on certain specific aspects. So, it does not take the entire river into consideration. It refers to certain issues that are actually dealt under those arrangements. And these arrangements do not provide all the informations, and so they have very limited scope, appeal and application. Among the 3 major transnational river basins that India has, and India is a part of, like Ganga and Brahmaputra, Meghna and Indus. In fact, Ganga, Brahmaputra, Meghna and Indus, this would occupy perhaps the largest river basin in the world. But there is no binding international agreement amongst all river basin countries. And as far as involving India, bilateral agreements are there between India and Bangladesh as far as the river Ganga only. And even with regard to river Ganga, This is limited to sharing of surface waters at the Faraka Barrage near their mutual borders. Then there is another agreement in which India is a party. It's called as the Indus Treaty, which was actually concluded in Karachi in the year 1960 between India and Pakistan. A very interesting arrangement. It is primarily to share the water resources of the river Indus and its tributaries. But even that is of a very limited appeal and application. But I must say that even during war period, we fought many wars, 1965 war and 1971 war. Even during those conflict situations, the working of this arrangement was unaltered, unaffected, undefeated, because it's mainly to do with the water resource requirement of both the countries. And if one country comes in the way of the use of the right by another country, there are other attendant consequential adverse impacts for that very country which blocks things. And so it has been so worked out that both would be losers if they don't respect. With the result that even at the time of war, this agreement has been in operation. The sum and substance of what I present before you is, international arrangements are, number one, very weak, number two, a very limited import and application, and number three, conflict resolution is the weakest of it, and everything is being resolved through negotiation and settlement of disputes to alternative mechanisms. There is no single court of law to deal with their problems. The international legal regime for you.